Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Rescue by Ryk Brown, narrated by Jeffrey Kafer. Chapter 1. Captain Tuplo stared at Josh as if he'd lost his mind, but the young man looked serious, and in all the years Connor had known Josh, the talkative pilot had never been able to keep a straight face for long. The captain studied the faces of the four visitors in Ghatazhak-style combat armor. All of them looked stoic as well, but from what he had heard about the Ghatazhak, he expected as much. Finally, he looked at Marcus. "You want to tell me what's going on here, Taggart?"
"You're not Connor Tuplo," Marcus said. "You're Nathan Scott."
"Nathan Scott. Captain Nathan Scott, commander of the Aurora. The guy from Earth."
"That's right.
And you've known this for how long?"
"Well, as long as we've known you, I suppose."
Connor looked at Josh. "By we, I assume he means you as well?"
"Yes, sir,"
Josh replied.
"Are you kidding me?"
Nelly exclaimed in disbelief.
"Oh, I don't believe this," Dalen said with excitement. "I'm flying with Natan."
"There's no way that Connor Tuplo is Natan,"
Nelly insisted.
"I agree," Connor added.
"Marcus and Josh were assigned to look after you, Nathan," Jessica explained, taking another step toward him.
"Don't call me that," Connor snapped. "I'm not Nathan Scott. I told you, I'm Connor Tuplo, owner and captain of the Seiki."
"You see?" Nelly said.
"You're Nathan Scott," Jessica said, "and the ship you think you own is actually named the Mirai, and technically it is owned by Deliza Ta'akar."
"Then how did I end up with it?"
Connor wondered.
"It's a long, complicated story, Nathan."
"I told you."
"I'm sorry,"
Jessica apologized. "I'll call you Connor for now if it'll make you feel better."
"It will make me feel better if someone will tell me the truth,"
Connor told her impatiently.
"We're trying to, Captain,"
Josh insisted.
"You are Nathan Scott.
Well, technically, you're a copy of yourself."
"What?"
"Josh,"
Jessica chided. "Maybe you should let me do the talking."
"Sorry."
"Oh, this is great," Dalen exclaimed.
"A copy?" Connor said doubtfully. "Of myself? Like a clone or something?"
"Yes."
Connor didn't know what to think at this point.
"Let's just assume for a moment that I believe you, which I don't. How is it that I don't know who I really am? Does it have something to do with the crash?"
"The crash is just a story they planted in your head," Jessica replied.
"Look, I'll explain everything to you, I promise, but not here. This place is within a Jung single jump range. We need to get someplace further away, someplace safe."
"That's what I've been saying," Nelly agreed.
"Shut up, Nelly," Marcus scolded.
"I'd love to go with you, lady," Connor said, "but I've barely got enough propellant left for one cycle. So unless you're offering to pay me or at least fill up my tanks, I'm afraid we're staying put."
"Come with us and we will give you all the propellant you can carry," General Tellus promised.
"What do we have to do for it?"
Connor asked suspiciously.
"Just come with us to Burgess and hear us out. That's all we ask," Jessica assured him.
"Burgess?" Connor said in surprise. "In the Sherma system?"
"That's the place."
Connor looked at Jessica and the general for a moment, then at Josh and Marcus.
"It'll get us off this rock and, what, like 100 light years away from the Jung?"
Marcus pointed out.
111.86 to be exact,
General Tellus corrected.
"That would take us completely out of the Pentaurus sector," Nelly realized. "That would be a damn good start."
"No strings attached?" Connor asked.
"None,"
Jessica promised him.
"And after I hear you out, if I still don't believe you,
you're free to leave."
"To go anywhere we want," Connor added, just to make sure.
"Anywhere you want,"
Jessica confirmed. "We'll even give you a list of systems where you could pick up some runs to keep you going."
"What makes you think we can't get some here?"
Connor wondered.
"The fact that you're almost out of propellant and out here in the middle of nowhere means you probably don't have the funds to pay Haven's meager port fees," General Tellus said.
He looked at the damaged cargo ramp.
"And your ship appears to be in need of repair. Since the Jung have locked down the Pentaurus cluster and will most likely do the same to the entire sector before long, your options appear somewhat limited."
"Something will turn up," Connor said.
"Something has," Jessica told him. "Us."
She stepped even closer to Connor, standing less than a meter away.
"Look at me," she said, gazing into his eyes. Tell me you don't remember me.
Connor stared into her eyes, hoping he'd be able to recognize her.
I'm sorry, he whispered sadly.
Jessica's spirits fell.
That's okay,
she said quietly. She looked up at him again. Because I do remember you. Come with us. Let us tell you what happened to you. What really happened to you. What have you got to lose?
Connor continued looking at her, captivated by the genuine sincerity in her eyes.
You can always return to this place afterward if you so choose, General Tellus added. We can even help you repair your ship.
Connor thought for a moment, weighing his options, then quickly realizing that he had very few.
Very well, he sighed. I'll hear you out, but after you fill up our propellant tanks. You have my word, General Tellus replied. Shall we depart?
Everyone back inside, Connor ordered as he turned around and started up the ramp.
We're going to Burgess.
We're not coming back here, right?
Nellie asked as she followed Marcus up the ramp.
The Saiki's cockpit windows filled with dust as she slowly lifted off the ground, leaving the dusty old Molo farm behind.
Jump us to orbit, Captain Tublo instructed Josh in a very matter-of-fact tone. I don't want to waste the propellant on a standard climb-out.
Even Haven has jump rules. Just do it, the captain stated, cutting him off.
If you're worried about Jess going back on her word...
Captain Duplo gave Josh a disapproving sidelong glance.
Do I have to take the controls, Josh?
No, sir,
Josh replied as he punched in the jump parameters and started the ship forward.
Jumping to orbit.
The cockpit windows turned opaque. When they cleared 2 seconds later, they were filled with the blackness and stars of space to their right, and the gas giant that Haven orbited to their left.
Use just enough propellant to get Tika's gravity to pull us away from Haven, then jump us to outside the system so we don't have to burn as long to change course for Sherma, the captain ordered.
I know how to do a minimum propellant departure, Captain,
Josh replied defensively. Besides, they'll give us the propellant, I'm telling you.
Forgive me if I don't take your word for it, Josh, the captain snapped.
Josh altered the Seiki's course just enough to steer toward the looming gas giant.
Are you mad at me, Captain?
I'm mad at somebody, that's for sure. I just haven't figured out who yet.
How do you mean?
Josh wondered.
Someone is lying to me.
No one is lying to you, Captain.
Captain Duplo looked at Josh.
The way I figure it, either all of you are lying or they are telling the truth and you and Marcus have been lying to me all along. Either way, I figure I have a right to be mad at somebody.
Josh was silent. He continued monitoring the ship's movement away from Haven and toward the gas giant, waiting for the right moment to execute the jump that would take them well outside the system and away from its gravitational influences. After several minutes, Josh finally spoke.
You know, we're just following orders.
So you didn't resign from the Alliance? The captain accused.
No, we resigned all right. We had to. Rescuing you is going against orders.
If you resigned, then whose orders were you following?
Jessica's,
Josh replied flatly. In case you haven't noticed, she's not exactly someone you want to piss off.
Josh checked the navigation display again. We'll be at our jump point in 2 minutes.
He looked back at Captain Tuplo.
Look, Captain, if you want to be mad at us, that's fine, but we're telling you the truth. You are Nathan Scott, not Connor Tuplo, and Nathan Scott would understand why we did what we did.
Captain Tuplo sighed. That's the problem, Josh. I'm not Nathan Scott. Even if you're all telling the truth and I am a clone, I don't have Nathan Scott's memories. I have mine, Connor Tuplo's, or at least those from the last 6 years. As far as I know, that's who I am.
Just hear them out, Captain,
Josh begged.
I intend to. We need the propellant, as well as the list of potential systems to fly, assuming they keep their word.
You really don't believe them?
No, I don't. He looked at Josh. Would you if you were me?
I'd at least want to listen, Josh argued, and not just fill my tanks, but to try to find out the truth about my past.
You're always talking about bits and pieces of memories that you can't string together. Maybe it's finally time to fill in all the blanks.
That's what worries me, Captain Tuplo admitted.
What do you mean?
I mean, why now? Why not 6 years ago?
He looked at Josh. There's more to this than all of you are letting on, isn't there?
Josh sighed, realizing he had said too much already.
Just hear them out, that's all.
Josh jumped down off the end of the Seiki's damaged cargo ramp, onto the tarmac at the Lawrence spaceport in Burgess.
Sorry it took us so long,
he said to Jessica and the general as they approached. Captain wanted to fly a low-consumption departure. I hope the controllers here aren't going to be too angry about our jumping in so low.
I will take care of it, General Tillis assured him.
He looked at Captain Tuplo as he came down the ramp, also jumping down the last half meter to the surface.
We can begin your refueling immediately if you'd like, Captain.
Yes, please, Connor replied. He turned to look at Marcus, who was also coming down the cargo ramp, followed by Dalen and Nelly. Marcus, Dalen, you two see to the refueling. Deliza and Loki walked up from behind the general, both of them looking as if they weren't sure they would be welcomed.
Loke!
Josh exclaimed, rushing to give his old friend a hug.
Josh!
Loki replied, embracing him with a smile. It's good to see you again.
Damn good to see you. How you been? How's Lael? She wise up and dump your sorry ass yet?
Not exactly, Loki replied, sighing.
What is it?
Josh wondered, noticing the concerned look on his old friend's face.
What's wrong?
Connor Tuplo, this is Loki Sheehan, General Tillis announced.
A pleasure to meet you, sir,
Loki greeted.
What the hell's going on?
Josh asked Loki again.
Likewise, Captain Tuplo replied, shaking Loki's hand.
Do you mind if I borrow your co-pilot for a few minutes?
Loki asked.
We have some catching up to do.
Go right ahead. And this is Deliza Ta'akar.
Connor nodded respectfully at the young woman as she stepped out from behind the general.
I suppose this is why you lured me here with promises of free propellant, so that this young woman could lay claim to my ship?
Oh, no, Deliza insisted. I gave that ship to you, Nathan.
He doesn't like to be called Nathan, Jessica warned her.
I'm sorry,
Deliza apologized. She paused for a moment, trying to decide what to say next.
May I just call you Captain?
That would be fine.
I promise you, I do not wish to take your ship from you,
Deliza continued.
As I said, I gave that ship to you. I mean, legally, yes, I am still the owner of the Mirai. I would have gladly signed over the title to you at the time, but we feared that creating such a document trail might put you at risk. So we decided to list the Mirai as lost in space.
But I have the title for the Seiki, Captain Tuplo argued. Bought and paid for with the settlement funds from the crash.
Yeah, well, that title was pretty much forged,
Jessica explained. We had Marcus take the Mirai someplace outside the sector and scrub her clean, so to speak.
I see,
the captain replied, one eyebrow raised. He studied their faces a moment. The Ghatazhak general was nearly expressionless and impossible to read, but the Ghatazhak female known as Jessica was different. Her expression was quite sincere, and she had been genuinely pleased to see him back on Haven. Although he could not read the general, he was sure that she believed she was speaking the truth, as did the young woman named Deliza. But with Deliza, there was something more, a fear or guilt. He wasn't sure which.
Ta'akar,
Connor said, recognizing the name. Any relation?
Yes,
Deliza admitted. My late father was Casimir Ta'akar. Connor pulled his head back, his eyes opening wider in surprise.
Doesn't that make you
rightful heir to the throne of Takara, yes,
Deliza finished for him. My father considered you a very close and trusted friend. The word trusted set off alarms in Connor's head.
As do I,
Deliza added. I only hope you can forgive me. Now he was really alarmed.
There's more going on here than you people are letting on, Connor accused. What if you want to tell me why I'm really here? We need you to help us conduct a rescue operation, General Tillis told him.
From where?
Coroner,
Connor laughed.
You're kidding, right?
He looked at their faces. None of them were smiling.
Shit, you're not kidding. Are you nuts? The Darvino system is crawling with Jung ships, and I'm sure Coroner has got boots on the ground, lots of them.
Jessica smiled at the captain's turn of phrase.
You are correct, the general replied, looking at Jessica. The Jung have occupied the surface of Coroner, which is why we need you and your ship.
Why me? Connor wondered.
Why my ship?
We need to extract at least 20 people, the general explained. Possibly as many as 50.
Why not just use one of those things?
Connor asked, pointing to the boxcar near the hangar.
They are too large and not terribly maneuverable, nor are they very accurate in their jumps. We need a ship that is just big enough to fit in a small space. And it needs a highly skilled pilot, one who is adept at jumping in very close to the surface. Connor's eyebrow went up again. How close?
Less than 10 meters, the general replied. It took a moment to sink in as Connor again couldn't tell if the general was kidding.
I'm afraid you've got the wrong guy, he finally replied.
Your ship cannot make such a precise jump? The general asked.
I'm sure it could, assuming everything was in proper working order, Connor replied. I mean, you've got the wrong guy. I've never made a close-in jump like that. Hell, I've never even jumped in at less than 10,000 meters, let alone less than 10.
I'm afraid you misunderstand me, Captain, the general said. I was not going to ask you to perform the jump. My intention was to ask Mr. Hayes.
Josh?
Connor's brow furrowed. Seriously? I mean, he's a good pilot. Okay, he's a great pilot, but 10 meters?
He has done it in less, Jessica assured Connor.
Connor looked at Jessica.
Really?
Jessica nodded.
Connor shook off his surprise. But you said you needed me and my ship. If you don't need me to pilot her, what is it you need me for?
Captain! Dalen hollered excitedly as he came jogging around the port engine nacelle. They've got a crew ready to start repairs on our ramp. They've got new struts, new braces, the works. They even want to replace the port shield generator for us with a brand new unit.
Actually, we were planning on replacing all three of your shield generators, General Tellis corrected. It is important that your ship be in top condition for the mission.
I haven't even agreed to the mission yet, Connor argued.
Nevertheless, we would still like to proceed with the repairs, the general insisted. It is the least we can do, considering the sacrifices you have made for us all in the past.
Right, Connor shrugged. He took in a deep breath and sighed. All right, sure, why not? Repair whatever you like, as long as I can still turn you down.
Dalen jumped for joy, then turned around and headed forward again, disappearing from view. Connor looked over at Josh and Loki in the distance. His young pilot was usually quite animated, but now he appeared subdued.
You still haven't told me why you need me on this mission of yours, Connor reminded the general.
General Tellis looked at Jessica.
Perhaps you should explain it to him.
Jessica nodded.
Walk and talk?
She asked Connor. She noticed his confusion.
Please, Captain, take a walk with me while I explain further.
Dumar studied the digital map of the Ronnie Enterprises Research and Development Lab.
It is an impressive facility, he admitted. I can see why Deliza did not want to move the project off-world. The cost would have been astronomical, and I doubt it would have been any more secure.
It was a difficult decision for her, Doran assured him, as it was going against her promise to Jessica. But she felt it was for the best. Had she spent the bulk of her resources to relocate the project, we would still be years from completion. And had her business dealings gone sour, we might not have been able to afford to continue the process to its end stage.
And you are at the end stage now? Dumar asked.
Dr. Sato sighed, unsure of how to respond.
We expected to go through one more cloning cycle, to be honest. Perhaps even two, just to be sure. This version still has only 80% of the genetic adjustments needed to ensure a successful restoration of Captain Scott's memories and personality.
There's also the issue that we would be transferring a consciousness that came from a genetically different host.
But he is the same. He is a clone, is he not?
The word is often misunderstood, Dr. Megal explained.
The person we all know as Nathan Scott does not currently exist, at least not as a whole person. His body exists, yes. In fact, the body that knows itself as Connor Tuplo is an exact replica of the body of Nathan Scott based on the DNA sample taken from him just before his death. That body is what most people understand a clone to be. We, on the other hand, refer to such exact copies as replicas, which is precisely what they are, physical copies that do not carry the essence of the original. In other words, the original version's consciousness, or what some people refer to as a soul.
But this Connor Tuplo, he looks like Nathan? Dumar wondered.
Yes, he looks like Nathan Scott, Dr. Sato replied. He even acts like Nathan Scott, or at least very similar. But he is not Nathan Scott, not in the true sense.
We believe that the personality, the emotions, and the memories are what makes up the human soul, Dr. Megal explained. Personality influences emotions, emotions influence memories, memories influence personality. They're all closely intertwined. To be complete, all three must be working together. Besides his physical appearance, Connor Tuplo has Nathan Scott's personality and his emotions, but not his memories.
And why not? Dumar asked, trying to follow along.
Centuries ago, the entire population of Nephilim were simple clones. We were grown to adulthood and awakened, but without the memories of those who had come before us. The personality and the emotions were both largely genetic, with some influence due to life experiences. We were essentially starting over with each cloning cycle. It wasn't until we discovered a method to transfer our memories from one body to the next that we were able to achieve something akin to immortality.
Was that your goal all along? Dumar wondered.
For the original research colony that started more than 1,000 years ago, yes. But after the biodigital plague ravaged the core, it became a means of survival. But because we had not yet discovered the means of transferring our memories from replica to replica, our progress was greatly hindered. We were only able to continue based on the notes of our predecessors, without the experience, wisdom, and instinct that they had developed.
And how did you achieve this?
As I explained, the personality and emotions of a human being are largely genetic, but are shaped by their life experiences, which of course are stored as memories. It was a matter of transferring memories from replica to replica. The issue to overcome was the fact that each person's brain cells are unique, far more so than anyone imagined. We had to find a way to make them uniform from person to person, as well as to make them fit a structure compatible with the technology used for the transfer.
Dr. Megal explained, "That is why we have been recloning him, in order to get his body into a genetic state that will give him the best chance of having fully restored memories, to become Nathan Scott once again, and not a mere replica." Dumar sighed. "If you knew this to be a problem, why did you even go through with the process to begin with?"
"That is a question you should be asking Jessica," Dr. Sato said.
"I believe I already know the answer," Dumar replied.
"Honestly, we did not think the original restoration process would go as poorly as it did," Dr. Megal said. "We could not have anticipated the problems the Coronair nanites would cause. That is part of the reason we kept the project here on Coronair, where nanite expertise was more readily available."
Dumar thought for a moment. "I do not believe it will be too difficult to get into your lab," he explained, changing the subject. "However, getting out the clone and all your equipment, which I assume is a rather sizable amount, will be problematic."
"How are we going to even get a ship large enough down to the surface?" Doran wondered.
"Yes, the moment any ship jumps into the system, the Jung will be all over it," Dumar agreed. "That is why the ship must jump in low and into concealment." Doran's eyebrows shot up. "I'm assuming you have such a place in mind?"
"The Crystal Caverns," Dumar said. "They are not far from here, perhaps half a day's journey. They are quite large, and the opening is equally massive."
"I've been to those caverns," Doran said. "They are not as big as you might think."
"They are big enough," Dumar insisted. "But that still doesn't solve the problem of getting the clone and all the equipment out of the city."
"Maybe we don't have to," Dr. Sato suggested. "I know this is probably difficult for you," Jessica said as they walked away from the Seiki and toward the hangar office.
"You think?" Connor replied with a hint of sarcasm.
"Tell me something, in all honesty." Jessica stopped walking and turned to look at him. "Don't I look at all familiar to you?"
"Are you supposed to?" Jessica sighed. "I'm sorry," Connor said, realizing her disappointment.
"That's all right. I guess I was just hoping that a part of you would have made the connection by now," Jessica said.
"The connection?"
"You see, you still have Nathan's memories locked up inside of you. They're just blocked off by some genetic wall or something. Sato and Megal explained it to me at least a dozen times, but I still don't completely get it."
"You think you don't get it?" Jessica smiled.
"You're so much like him. Except for the beard, of course."
She sighed again.
"God, I've missed you."
They continued their stroll toward the hangar in silence. When they reached the door, Connor held it open for her. "Were we close?"
"Yes," Jessica replied. "At one time, very much so."
"Wow, now I'm really sorry I don't remember you."
"This is really weird," Jessica admitted as they entered the office. "Give us the room," she instructed the people inside. After they left, she sat down. "You know, I've thought about this day for 7 long years, ever since you surrendered yourself to the Jung."
"No disrespect to your friend, but why would anyone do that?"
We're doing so to prevent an all-out war."
"I know," Connor said. "I mean, I know the story. I've heard people talk about it. I've heard Josh talk about it, and talk about it. But weren't you already in an all-out war? I mean, if the Jung haven't been able to do anything until now, doesn't that prove his surrender was unnecessary?"
Or it proves that it was, Jessica countered. The Jung have a lot of ships, and I mean a lot. When I left the Sol Sector, intelligence estimates put their numbers at a minimum of 100 ships within 100 light-years of Earth, and we strongly suspected they had ventured out deeper into the galaxy as well. For all we knew, there were hundreds more ships out there.
But they were all FTL ships, right? Connor surmised, which means it would have taken decades for the Jung to mass them into a coordinated strike on Alliance space.
Right on both counts.
Again, then, his surrender makes no sense. The result would have likely been the same.
Except that millions, possibly billions of people, innocent people I might add, would already be dead. Nathan knew that. He had no way of knowing if it would work in the long or the short term. If he had, I'm sure the decision would have been much easier. But regardless of whether he was right or wrong, he did it for the right reasons. You did it for the right reasons.
I'm still not convinced I did it, that I'm him, Connor reminded her.
Jessica thought for a moment, studying him. Even through the beard, she could still see Nathan's face. The eyes, the cheeks, the chin. She'd even seen a hint of that same smile that always engendered trust.
They said you might have flashes of memory.
Who said?
Doctors Sato and Megal.
Connor's eyes lit up. I remember them. They were my doctors at the hospital on Coronair. They were in charge of my recovery after the crash. A realization hit him. Are you saying
they were the doctors who cloned you?
Connor shook his head in disbelief. I was under the impression that cloning was frowned upon on Coronair.
Actually, they've been cloning human organs and tissue on Coronair and throughout the Pentaurus sector for centuries,
Jessica explained.
Just not complete human beings. The doctors that cloned you were from Nephelm.
Never heard of it, Connor admitted.
Sol Sector. Everyone there clones.
Are Sato and Megal from Nephelm?
Yep.
Then they're...
Yep.
Connor sat for a moment, letting the new knowledge sink in. So I was cloned by clones?
Jessica smiled. It was the first time he had spoken about himself as if he believed her.
Yep.
Connor noticed her smile. Slip of the tongue, I still don't believe it.
So you're telling me you never had flashes of memories, memories you don't recognize, memories you can't make sense of?
Connor sighed. Yes, I have them, but they're not the kind you're thinking of. They're about my family, my parents, my sisters, my older brother. At least that's who I think they are. They could all be neighbors or kids I went to school with or actors I saw in a vid play or something. Nothing about space battles and the like.
Connor looked at her.
And unfortunately, nothing about you.
Or they could be memories of your real family.
Real as in Connor Tuplo's or Nathan Scott's, Connor said. I suppose that's the real question.
Well, at least you're willing to ask it,
Jessica said comfortingly. That's a start.
Connor sat back in his chair, thinking. Suppose for argument's sake I believe you. Why now? Why not a month ago? 6 months ago? Or 6 years ago?
They've been working on a way to completely restore your memories.
They can do that? All of a sudden, Connor was curious. I thought clones were just copies, like empty shells that had to learn everything all over again.
Sound familiar? Jessica asked.
Connor frowned, not liking the comparison. He remembered waking up that day 6 years ago with no memory of who he was or what had happened. It was a terrifying feeling, one he wished he could forget.
Sorry.
So the Nephelmians can transfer the memories from one clone to another. Then why don't I have Nathan Scott's memories?
The Nephelmians have been genetically engineered over generations to make it possible to transfer chemically stored memories from one host to another. In this way, they have achieved a type of immortality. They just transfer their memories from clone to clone. Dr. Sato is over 300 years old, or her memories are.
That's hard to imagine, Connor said. So my genetics weren't right? If that's the case, then why try to clone me?
Because they thought they could overcome the problem and at least give you most of your memories back,
Jessica explained.
Did anyone think to ask me? I mean, him, Nathan?
We did. You said yes. I mean, he said yes.
So now you're asking me, is that it?
No, we already asked you, Jessica said. 6 years ago, when you first woke up as a clone, your memories were tattered. They were there, but they were disconnected, full of holes. The connections kept coming and going. It was driving you mad. You begged us to fix it, but we couldn't. Finally, Dr. Megal suggested that they wipe your memories and let you believe you were someone else. He offered you the solution and you took it, but only on the condition that they continue their research on your full restoration, to make you Nathan Scott again.
So there is no Connor Tuplo from Raccoon?
No, there isn't.
And I never went to flight school?
Well, you did, but not on Raccoon. On Earth, at the EDF Academy in North America.
Connor leaned forward, burying his head in his hands. This is really a lot to deal with, he admitted. And I'm still not sure I believe any of it. Hell, I don't even know whether or not I want to believe it.
Do you want to know who you really are? Jessica asked.
That's just it. I don't know. As Connor Tuplo, my life is pretty mundane. But it's not a bad life. I have my own ship, I get to travel, I'm my own boss.
You were stranded on Haven, Jessica reminded him.
You were probably a few weeks away from eating Mola for breakfast, lunch, and dinner.
Mola isn't that bad.
Yeah, it is, Jessica insisted.
It really is.
We would have found a way off of that rock eventually, Connor argued. Besides, I'm not sure being this Nathan guy is all that appealing. It sounds as if he's had a hell of a lot of responsibility resting on his shoulders. How do I know I even want to have his memories? They might not be all that good.
I'm not going to lie to you, Jessica said. I was there with you every step of the way, and I've got a lot of really bad memories that I wish I could forget.
Hell, they almost drove me over the edge. Had it not been for the Ghatazhak training, I don't know what would have become of me. But despite all that, I wouldn't give up any of it. Because those memories, the good and the bad, are what makes me, me.
The Nephelmians are right. Personality, emotions, and memory. All of them make you who you are. Without all three of them, you are incomplete. And I think deep down inside, you know it. You know there's a piece of you missing, Nathan. And until you find it, you won't be whole. That's why you made Sato and Megal promise to keep working on a way to unlock your memories.
Connor stared at her, trying to remember a time when he recognized her as a friend. She certainly was easy to look at, and he could see the sincerity in her eyes. As much as he wanted not to believe her, he couldn't. I can't promise you anything, Connor finally said. Not yet, but I am still willing to listen on one condition.
What's the condition?
Jessica wondered. You have to feed me first. So, how's he been doing? Loki asked, as he and Josh watched the spaceport ground crew finish refueling the Saiki.
He's been good.
Is he anything like the old Captain Scott?
Sometimes yes, sometimes no,
Josh admitted. Does he ever have any memory flashes?
He talks about them here and there, but nothing significant. What's going on, Loki?
How's Marcus?
Loki, enough with the small talk,
Josh insisted.
It's me, what the hell's going on? Why did they come for us now? Does it have something to do with the Jung?
Sort of, yeah. Josh could see the concern on his friend's face. Come on, Loke. Loki looked at the ground. It's Lael, he said, nearly losing his composure. He looked back at Josh, tears in his eyes. And Ailsa. They're still on Coronair.
What? Wait, who's Ailsa?
Our daughter.
Daughter? When did that happen?
She was born 6 months ago, Loki told him, barely able to hold back his tears.
Why didn't you tell me?
How was I supposed to get in touch with you, Josh?
Through Jessica, how else?
It's not like I have access to a jump comm drone, Loki said, and the Sherma system isn't exactly on the beaten path.
Oh, man, Josh exclaimed. How did this happen?
We were on our way back from a short business trip when the Jung invaded. Josh, I saw the Avondale come apart. One moment she was on my sensors, then... We tried to rescue them. We even had a few of the Avondale's fighters trying to cover us. Josh looked past his friend at the heavily damaged corporate shuttle near the hangar.
Is that?
He began, pointing at the damaged shuttle. Loki glanced back over his shoulder. The girl who took Lael's place when she left to have Ailsa was in the back when we were hit. She didn't make it. If they would have been in the back when... Josh reached out and grabbed his friend, pulling him in tight and wrapping his arms around him as Loki started sobbing.
We'll get them out, buddy, you and me. We'll find a way, I promise you. We'll find a way.
Jessica pulled the vehicle through the front gate and headed up the short dirt path that led from the main road to the main house. It had taken them only 10 minutes to travel here from the Lauren spaceport. The drive had been somewhat relaxing for Connor. Meandering roads dotted with similar properties, fields of crops, small groves of fruit-bearing trees, all spotted with ponds of varying sizes. Lawrence itself had been nothing more than a small collection of shops, restaurants, and government buildings, along with a few apartments for those people who wanted to live in the city itself. On Burgess, cities were for gathering and trading goods.
People lived in the country, only traveling into town when they needed supplies. It was a life that Connor had often considered for himself. Simple and quiet, with nothing more to worry about than the crops you grew and traded for other goods. A wife, children, and a piece of land he could call his own. What he couldn't understand was why he found the idea of such a life so appealing. According to his record or that of Connor Tuplow, he had no exposure to such a lifestyle. Raccoon, the world on which he was supposed to have been raised, was fully industrialized and grew no crops of its own. If he had grown up there, it would be unlikely that he would even know what a farm was, let alone think it was a good place for him to live out his life. The dirt road passed through a small grove of trees covered with blue-green leaves. Once they were through the grove, the path split out into several different roads, each leading to a separate house. They followed the center path toward a two-story wood-framed home, surrounded by trees and grass, as well as a few well-placed flower gardens. The air was clean and fresh, a stark contrast to the polluted air he normally found around spaceports and the congested cities. "How many people live here?" Connor wondered as they pulled up to the main house.
"My parents and my daughter, Anya. I only stay here for a few days a week. Most of the time I live on base with the rest of the Ghatazhak."
Jessica climbed down out of the vehicle.
"My brothers and their families live in these other houses. They all work this farm together."
"Is this where you grew up?" Connor asked. "It's nice."
"No, we've only lived here for about 6 years now. We're all from Earth, born and raised, just like you."
"Just like me," he thought. Connor had no memory of Earth. As far as he knew, he had never been there. Of course, he had no memory of Raccoon either, just bits and pieces, images that occasionally flashed in and out of his mind. For all he knew, those images could have been from Earth and not Raccoon. "Why did you all move here?" Connor asked. "I thought Earth was supposed to be a great world, some sort of magical paradise with everything anyone could ever want."
Jessica looked at him, puzzled. "Is that what people out here think of Earth?"
"I don't know, that's just the impression I got from all of Josh's stories."
"Don't listen to Josh," Jessica laughed. "He compares everything to Haven. I left because I wanted to stay with the Ghatazhak and continue my training. My parents came because they were helping to raise Anya, and they didn't want me to be separated from her by such vast distances. My brothers came along because it made sense to keep the entire family together. Besides, at the time, the Earth was still pretty screwed up from the Jung attacks. It still is in a lot of ways."
"So, not so much the magical paradise that Josh made it out to be, huh?" Connor said, as he followed her onto the front porch.
"Don't get me wrong, Earth is an amazing planet. Of all the worlds I've seen, it has the greatest variation of climates, culture, geography. You name it, Earth's got it."
Jessica stepped through the front door.
"Anya!"
A squeal of delight echoed from somewhere in the home, followed by the sound of tiny bare feet running on the hardwood floors. A moment later, a little girl wearing light blue overalls with her hair in blonde pigtails bolted through one of the nearby doors, ran across the room, and leapt into Jessica's open arms.
"How have you been, kiddo?"
she asked as she squeezed her tight and kissed the side of her face repeatedly.
"Have you been behaving?"
"No,"
little Anya squealed in delight.
"Don't believe her,"
Jessica's mother said as she entered the room.
"Mom, this is Connor Tuplow. Connor, this is my mother, Laura."
Laura reached out to shake Connor's hand, looking at him with a curious expression.
"Have we met before?"
"No, ma'am," Connor replied as he shook her hand. "It's a pleasure to meet you."
"The pleasure's mine, Mr. Tuplow. You do look familiar, though. Are you staying for dinner?"
Connor looked at Jessica.
"Yes, he's staying for dinner." "Are you sleeping here tonight, Jess?"
Anya asked.
"Sorry, sweetie, but I've got to take Mr. Tuplow back to his ship after dinner," Jessica explained. "But I'll come home for a few days soon, I promise."
"Come along, Anya,"
Laura said.
"Help me set the table."
Jessica and Connor watched them leave the room, then Connor spoke. "She doesn't call you Mom?" he wondered.
"She's not my biological daughter. Her mother was a friend of mine. She and her husband were killed when the Jung glassed their world, Anya's twin sister as well. I couldn't let her become an orphan. There were already so many of them, both from Tana and on Earth. So I took her in, and my parents and I have raised her ever since. I think of her as my daughter, but truth is, I'm more like a big sister. The main thing is that she's happy and safe."
"Seems like she is."
"Come on,"
Jessica said, gesturing for him to follow her. She led him through the house and out into the backyard. Stretched out before them was a valley of rolling hills, bordered by mountains on the far side.
The setting sun was about to dip down behind the mountains, casting an odd orange shadow across the land. Above them, Burgess's moon, Anthon, filled a quarter of the sky, casting its own bluish glow wherever the light of Sherma did not reach.
Pretty cool, huh?
It's beautiful, Connor agreed. After staring at the sunset for a moment, he asked, Have I met your mother before? I mean, did he?
Actually, no, Jessica said as she sat down on the back porch steps. Nathan never actually met my mother. He was on the news a lot, though. When they first thought the Aurora was lost, Nathan's picture was on the news because his father was running for president. A lot of people say the sympathy vote is what got his father elected.
Here everyone seems to think of him as an Atan, Connor commented, one eyebrow raised.
I take it you don't?
A mythical savior foretold in the legends of a cult religion? Interesting bedtime stories for children and placebos for the oppressed masses.
Maybe, Jessica agreed. But you have to admit you did save the cluster from oppression.
He saved them, for all the good it did. If you ask me, saving them only weakened the entire sector, making them a soft target for the Jung.
You'd rather have Caius still in power?
I don't know, Connor replied honestly. I have no memory of him, only what I've been told. At the very least, he would have made a more formidable opponent for the Jung.
I disagree, Jessica replied. We took him down with one jump ship, a band of rebels, and the Coronari. The Jung attacked with a fleet of jump ships. The old Empire wouldn't have lasted any longer.
Perhaps. Like I said, I don't remember the Empire. I don't remember much of anything prior to the crash.
What do you remember about the crash? Jessica wondered.
Only what I read, Connor replied. A faulty thruster caused the transport I was flying to crash. I was the only survivor. I was in a coma for 2 years and woke up not knowing who I was or what had happened. I was offered the Seiki as part of my settlement by the company that made the faulty thruster. I think it was the owner's personal shuttle or something.
Dinner's ready,
Jessica's mother called from inside.
Let's eat,
Jessica said, rising to her feet.
Connor followed Jessica from the vehicle to the office at the Ghatazhak hangar at the Lawrence spaceport.
It was late and most of the Ghatazhak personnel had left for the evening. Only a small security detachment remained along with the mechanics working on the Seiki.
Are they going to work all night? Connor asked.
If that's what it takes, sure, Jessica replied.
You still haven't told me what you want from me and my ship, he reminded her.
That's not my place,
Jessica explained as they entered the office. Inside, Connor found General Tellus and the rest of the Seiki's crew all waiting for him.
Shouldn't you guys be out there helping them fix the ship?
Are you kidding?
Dalen replied. Those guys are so far over my head. We'd only be in the way, Captain, trust me. Connor looked at Marcus, who nodded his agreement.
Captain, General Tellus began, I trust you are well fed?
Yes, thank you. Connor looked at his crew.
Don't worry, Captain. Marcus assured him. They took us into Lawrence and treated us. This city's got some fine eats, let me tell you.
Since the mission we are proposing affects all of you, I thought it would be best if all your crew were present when we shared the details of how you got to be known as Connor Tuplo, assuming, of course, that you have no objections.
Connor thought for a moment, looking at the faces of his crew.
Come on, Captain,
Dalen begged. Nellie said nothing, still looking as undecided as Connor.
Well, apparently Marcus and Josh already know more than I do, so I don't suppose it will hurt for Dalen and Nellie to know as well. After all, crew is family, right, Marcus?
Damn straight, Captain.
Very well, General Tellus replied. Please, he added, gesturing for Connor to sit. This will take some time, I'm afraid.
Connor sighed as if facing his own execution. He took his seat, then looked at the general.
You must all understand that everything we are about to tell you must be kept in the strictest of confidence. Your very lives, and possibly the lives of billions more, may depend on your secrecy.
Then why even tell us? Nellie wondered.
Because you have a right to know, not only what we are asking you to do, but why, the general explained.
Plus, what he said about billions of lives depending on it probably doesn't really apply now, Jessica added.
It still might, General Tellus disagreed.
Oh, come on, Jessica argued. The Jung have already broken the ceasefire and they have jump drives. I doubt they're going to care that Nathan is still alive. For all we know, they might not even consider a clone to be the same as the original. A lot of people don't, you know.
Arguments aside, it would be best if none of this was repeated outside of present company, the general insisted. Do you understand?
Nellie and Dalen both nodded.
Very well, the general said. He looked at Jessica. Lieutenant?
7 years ago, Jessica began, you, Captain Nathan Scott, surrendered to the Jung as a war criminal. He knew that by taking full responsibility for the KKV strike against the military base at Juanok, which resulted in collateral damage costing millions of civilian lives on the Jung homeworld, Nor Patri, he could put a stop to the war between the Jung and the Alliance. He knew that by sacrificing himself, billions would be saved on both sides. That is the kind of man Nathan Scott was, and that is the kind of man you are.
Connor stared at Jessica. So if the Jung found out that he was still alive?
They would not be happy, Jessica replied.
Prior to the Jung invasion of the Pentaurus Cluster, it is logical to assume that an all-out war would follow such a discovery, General Tellis added. Now there is some debate over what their reaction might be and if it even matters at this point. So that's why you're telling me all this now? Connor wondered. Because you think it's safe for the truth to get out? A bit of an unnecessary risk, don't you think?
I don't get it, Nellie interrupted. If the Jung finding out that Nathan Scott is still alive is so risky to begin with, why did you even rescue him in the first place?
Because it was Nathan, Jessica replied, and because he didn't deserve to die. Chapter 2 Jessica walked into the Admiral's office, located deep inside the Karazar asteroid base in orbit high above the Earth.
Lieutenant Commander Nash reporting as ordered, she announced, standing at attention and offering a salute.
At ease, Lieutenant Commander, Admiral Dumar said, returning her salute. He nodded at the aide who had led her in, who quickly left the Admiral's office and closed the door behind him. Take a seat.
Beg the Admiral's pardon, but I'd like to know what we're going to do about rescuing Captain Scott.
Take a seat, Lieutenant Commander, the Admiral repeated, more firmly this time. When she did not immediately take her seat, he looked up from his data pad. Her eyes were full of anger and determination, neither expression unusual to see on the young Spec Ops-trained Lieutenant Commander. But he also saw frustration and panic, both of which he had never witnessed in those eyes. She had been through a lot in the last 2 years, more specifically in the last 3 weeks. The rescue of Dr. Sorensen and her family, the destruction of Tana, the loss of her friend. Had it not been for the infant Anya, who had miraculously survived the devastating attack, the lieutenant commander might have completely lost herself. And now the loss of one of her closest friends, her captain, who had surrendered himself to the Jung only a day ago. I won't ask again, the Admiral added, still staring at her. Jessica begrudgingly took a seat across the desk from the Admiral.
You asked to see me, sir?
Yes, I did, the Admiral replied. I'm reassigning you.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.